Here's just pictures of four of the existing LNG import facilities that we have in the United States, and you can actually see there's one off of Massachusetts, one off of Georgia, one off of Maryland, and one of three that we have in the Gulf Coast region. Now, what is liquefied natural gas? It's natural gas that's cooled to a minus 320 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, what this does is it reduces the volume by over 600 times, which it makes it easier to transport and store. So in other words, let's just say if we had a cubic foot of natural gas, there's a certain amount of BTU within that, but the same cubic foot of liquefied natural gas would have 600 times the heating value. So you can see where storing the liquid or transporting the liquid, you are actually storing and transporting a much, much higher heating value than with pure methane. So you can see here, a ton of liquefied natural gas is equivalent to 47 MMBTUs or 47 million BTU. And one ocean-going LNG tanker can hold the equivalent of 3 BCF of natural gas. Pricing around the world varies from region to region. In Japan, they price LNG landed off of the price of crude oil that's imported, the so-called Japanese cocktail. What it amounts to is just the average price for the crude oil that's been purchased as cleared through their customs. And so it's Japanese cleared customs crude pricing, but it's just referred to as the Japanese cocktail. In Korea and Taiwan, again, it's the price of LNG landed is tied to the BTU equivalent basket of crude oil postings. In the UK, continental Europe, and Southeast Asia, it's a combination of oil and coal prices, again, converted to a BTU basis. And then the pricing for LNG on a BTU basis is the equivalent. Now, in the United States and Canada, we have been traditional importers, and we have very limited export facilities. But we have a competitive natural gas marketplace. As you all know from your studying in earlier lessons, we have the New York Mercantile Exchange. So we have an open, active, competitive marketplace for natural gas. Now, Russia, China, and the Middle East, they regulate the price. The various countries, the governments do, and they actually subsidize the price for their citizens. You can see here that because of the growth in the shale gas, we have steadily declined our imports over the years. Now, the U.S. as an exporter, some of the reasons it makes sense for us, we do have a surplus gas supply. The shale plays and the tight formations have resulted in abundant, relatively cheap supply of natural gas. $3 or less is an extremely cheap price for natural gas. And the EIA estimates that we're producing about 3 BCF a day more supply than we have market for. And as I mentioned in the previous slide, we have a competitive natural gas-based pricing market. This is actually causing some renegotiations of some of the existing global contracts. In other words, Japan sees the coming of LNG exports by the United States, and so they're already talking to some of their suppliers and saying, look, we want to get off of this crude oil pricing type of mechanism in our contracts and convert over to some type of natural gas index. We have existing LNG import facilities, those pictures I showed you in the beginning, and we actually, believe it or not, we are exporting virtually at the moment. Since we no longer need natural gas imports in the form of LNG. What's happening is those entities in the United States who have contracted for tanker loads are literally selling them mid-sea, so to speak, sending them to different ports rather than coming to the United States. And then we actually have had for about 20 years a small LNG export facility off the coast of Alaska in a point called Kenai, and that's been operated by ConocoPhillips. You can see here now the red squares represent existing LNG points. Again, off of Massachusetts, Cove Point, Maryland, Elba Island, Georgia, and then we have about four in the Gulf Coast area. Now, these are going to be the logical facilities to export. They have about 60 to 70% of the infrastructure in place already. They can handle tankers for offloading. They have onshore storage, they have connections with pipeline companies. So what they're doing is they're building the the liquefaction trains. We talked about the fact that the natural gas has to be super cooled. Well, that takes a liquefaction facility or train to be built. So in other words, they've got a lot of the infrastructure already in place. So some of these other companies that believe they're going to dive into this particular arena are not going to have the facilities. It's going to cost them a considerable amount more investment. You can see here, of course, the natural gas exports and re-exports by country. Again, we have declined in terms of our imports, and then all of a sudden you can see we've actually started to do some exporting. And then the ways that it gets to a market, again, this is that logistics and value chain we talked about for natural gas. In the case of exporting LNG, you can see here that the wellhead gas is going to move by pipeline to the liquefaction facility, and then it gets shipped to a particular port of entry where it's regasified and then distributed to the various areas of need. So it's sort of the opposite process that we've been used to for decades now, where we actually receive the LNG and we regasify it and we utilize it through the pipeline system to the various end users. Pricing wise, again, here in the United States, we've got a financial natural gas forward market, which you're familiar with, is the NYMEX, provides price discovery, so everyone knows what the price is. Now, just currently, based on the one-year average price for natural gas at Henry Hub, it's approximately $3.05 at the time that I put this particular lecture together. Now, these are the estimated supply chain costs, okay, in U.S. dollars per MMBTU. Approximately $2.15 represents the process for the liquefaction. Shipping overseas is about $1.25. Regasification at the new port of entry is approximately 70 cents per MMBTU. So you have total costs of about $4.10. So in this particular situation, you're really around $7.15. And I apologize, this still says 705 on it. Now, when we compare that to world pricing, you can see that there are not that many places in which current LNG exporters can make money at $7.15. Now, throughout Asia, that's still a pretty good deal, and they're still going to make money in parts of South America. But over in Europe, you could not, at the present time, export LNG and make money over there. Now, this situation has dramatically changed. One of the events that created impetus for the U.S. to consider exporting LNG had to be back in March of 2011 with the Fukushima nuclear power plant disaster in Japan. As I mentioned earlier, Japan is solely dependent on imports for natural gas and imports in the form of LNG. Well, at the time, they shut down all of their nuclear power plants. So the demand for natural gas in Japan spiked, and we were seeing prices upwards of $14 per MMBTU. So you can imagine at the time, those planning the LNG export facilities out of the United States were expecting extremely lucrative business and very, very large profit margin, such as is not the case today. And in fact, Japan is looking at relicensing their nuclear power plants again.